It is because of His amazing grace that we are here today. Let's just celebrate that this morning. He is a good God. He loves you. He loves me. Oh, let's pour our hearts out this morning. Who brings our care? Is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole world with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a heavenly love. And you would take my place. And you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. And I would be saved. I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, 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 oh.
Make sure you grab a seat. Oh, you already have. Wanted to remind you of a couple things, a couple ways to give. If you are so inclined, we appreciate everyone's faithful giving. Also on your connection card, you can place this in the offering plate as you exit this morning, Pastor Dan, Richie, our staff, we'd love to pray for you all, so please include that there. Windy Hill, this past Wednesday night, we had bingo at Windy Hill. Windy Hill is our low income here in the area, and every month we go over and sup with them. That's a church phrase. We had a great time. Miss Mindy, thank you for organizing that. And you can see all the amazing photos from our bingo. Okay, Pastor Dan forgot to take pictures. Yeah, it's hard to put stuff on social. And Pastor Dan did get the first B-I-N-G-O. I'm just saying, there's a lot of skill in bingo, and I was being looked upon in a positive light. So it was a great time. Thank you, Miss Mindy. Appreciate that. Next Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, the 31st, we have a... Did you put the slide up? No? Oh, it's there it is. Our next worship night. And we have ice cream. So we're going to do... It was so great that first time, we're going to repeat it. And so hope everyone... this is an opportunity to invite some other friends. And we're looking for those who would like to share what God has been doing in your life lately, recently. I'm not putting Linda on the spot, but Linda, it'd be great to hear what God's been doing in your life lately. If you would like to share any part of your story, please let me or Richie know, and we will get you on the list for that night to just share and encourage others about so important. You know, there's so many valleys that we walk through that can be really encouraging to hear how other people are doing it, and what encouragement that can be to not give up and to continue to trust. This morning, as we transition into our time of prayer and reflection, again, this is one of my favorite parts of the service where it doesn't have anything to do with me or Richie or anyone around you. It's between you and Almighty God. It's an opportunity to just pause, to not look at our phones, to not look at anyone else, but just to close our eyes and be quiet and seek the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And if you'd like to come up during this time of prayer, you can light a candle. If there's something heavy on your heart or you want to pray for somebody as a symbol, if you'd like to take the elements back to your chair, or you can take it up here at the altar if you'd like. But it would be a prayer something like this, and if you'll just pray with me as we lead into this time. It'd be, Jesus, if this morning, if I'm going to take communion, I want to remember that you died on the cross for me, and that as I take the elements, as I take and drink the juice, that it represents the blood that was spilled for you, and the bread represents your broken body there on the cross. And this morning, I remember you, because we do this in remembrance of you. We remember that you died for us, and we thank you, because we come to you and you take away all of our sin and the penalty of that sin so that we can spend eternity with you. And communion, the Last Supper, represents that. So this morning, we pray during this time that we would connect through the power of the Holy Spirit to pray. To pray for our country, to pray for our current president, to pray for the elections, local elections, to pray for our family, our parents, our children, our siblings, pray for our friends. And most of all, we pray for ourselves that we would be in a place that we would call on you, Lord, that we would call on the Lord this morning in worship, in prayer, in praise, that we would call on you in time of need and protection and wisdom and direction. We call on the name of the Lord this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
For all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in. I owe all to you. I owe.
thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above it all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cry, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. And if you've been forgiven, if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb.
Yeah.
If you walk in the veil, if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever and amen. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear people say, holy to the King of Kings, holy, you will always be, holy, holy forever. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries,
song you have in your heart.
Just tell the Lord that you are here. You're here to worship. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say, to reflect on our own lives and just continue on a daily basis to get into your word, Lord, and the words that you have given us so that we can just transform and be more like you. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to our Foxcroft friends. Great to have you guys. I rode by the campus the other day on my motorcycle. It was a great ride. So, I want to ask you kind of a just sort of a question this morning. When God is working in your life, when God is doing something in your life, just if you can just kind of bear with me, isn't it true that involves some aspect of coming clean with some kind of sin in our life? Now, there's times where we're like, no, I think I've been doing okay, and God just like stirring up and things are going great. I get that. But I would say this morning that in my life and in the lives of many Christians, when God wants to do something significant in your life, He's going to bring up something that's not been resolved, something that's not been handled, something that's not been dealt with in the past. And it's great to have God's restoration and His forgiveness, but here's what I'm saying. It usually involves coming clean about something in the past, either behavior or a sin. And here's the hard part. Here's the rub. This is the difficult part where we're like, okay, God, I'll confess that sin. I've kept it quiet. I will agree with you about that. But oftentimes, the sin that we committed, or the pattern, or whatever that we haven't dealt with, it is going to have a direct relationship in bringing pain on a particular person that we know and or love. I remember a friend, many churches I served with, and he and his wife had admitted that one of them had an affair. And they, in order to get closer to God, they had to deal with the affair. Now, there's a physical part, but there's also an emotional part about that affair. But there's also that part where the second day after they got married, they weren't vulnerable to have an affair. They were like 15 years into their marriage. And after 15 years, one of them was vulnerable to having an affair. Therefore, there's some kind of contribution in both within the marriage that made them susceptible and or weak or vulnerable. And so in order for them to come clean and get close to God, they had to deal with specific patterns and issues in their own life. And so here's what I want you to do is consider this. In order for God to use me greatly, He's going to dig up unresolved things in the past. I'm not saying that there was a move. You go to a counselor and they're like, well, there's like things that happened to you in your childhood. We need to uncover those. I'm not talking about that. God will reveal to you, your heart knows it. Like this morning as you hear my words, like if there's something He wants to deal with you about, bam, you already know what it is. There's something, if there is something, it's already right there. It's up here. But in order for God to take you and use you greatly, or have that great relationship that you've always wanted with God, we have to deal with these unresolved, unconfessed things in the past. And I hear churches and Christians, we're crying out for revival. Revival, Lord, revive us. And historically, revivals only occur after a group of people, wherever it starts, but they are confessing, which means I agree with God about what I did, my actions, that it's a sin. I'm confessing my sin and I'm turning from it. And that's what means repentance. Repentance means a 180 of sin. Whoa, that's kind of heavy. Well, yeah, I know. Because here's the interesting thing. We're going to see these brothers of Joseph, Jacob's 11 sons. And they are going to leave Joseph and go back home. And they are going to tell their father, we are liars. We are criminals because we sold your favorite son into human trafficking. And he's alive. And he's the number two guy in Egypt. And he wants us all to come there. I can only imagine what that conversation was like. You think you've had some awkward Thanksgiving or Christmas dinners with extended relatives and they're bringing up stuff? Wait till Thanksgiving this election, right? It's going to be a repeat of the one we just had 4 years ago. All right. Where did we leave off? Last week, Genesis 45. Joseph revealed to his brothers, it's me. I'm the prime minister of Egypt. Come close to me. And I'm number two. And they were like, could have heard a pin drop. Except for Joseph was weeping and wailing, ugly cry. My brothers, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. There's 5 years left of the famine at this particular point. Joseph's like, hey, my brothers, you gotta go get dad and bring all your stuff and bring it here. We're gonna set you up. We got 5 more years of the famine. Worst part of the famine's not even here yet. I'm gonna take care of you. I love you. I've forgiven you. And he wants them to go bring back my father. I want to see him again. So, when God's moving in my family, there's two primary for this morning. There's two primary people that we're looking at today. Number one is Jacob. Jacob, remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, patriarchs. And we're going to talk about Jacob, but we're also going to talk about Joseph and his role in the family. So when God's moving in my family, you've got to trust that God is working behind the scenes with everybody. So let's jump in right where we left off last week, verse 16 of chapter 45. When the news reached Pharaoh's palace that Joseph's brothers had come, Pharaoh and his officials were pleased. This was good. Pharaoh said to Joseph, tell your brothers, do this. Load your animals, return to the land of Canaan. Jacob's up in Hebron area. And bring your father back down and your families back to me. This is coming from Pharaoh. I will give you the best of the land in Egypt, and you can enjoy the fat of the land. That's a good sign. You're to direct them. Do this. Take some of the carts from Egypt for your children and your wives. Get your father and come. Never mind about your belongings, because the best of all of Egypt will be yours. You go back into your tent. We're not sure they're actual houses, but kind of Bedouin. Go into your tent and you look around and you're like, you know, I'm heading back down to Egypt. I'm going to have a roof over my head. What do I need? Like, not a whole lot. Where we're going is going to be so great. Verse 21. So the sons of Israel did this. Who's Israel? Israel is Jacob. Jacob's name by God was changed to Israel, which is the 12 tribes of Israel later on, which is Israel today. Joseph gave them carts as Pharaoh had commanded, and he gave them provisions for their journey. I mean, hooked them up. Road trip to and from. We're going to take care of you guys. To each of them, he gave new clothing. But to Benjamin, yeah, he gave 300 shekels of silver, 5 sets of clothes. Now, I don't know why he did this for Benjamin. Benjamin's got to bring all this. And it's not like he can say, hey, Joseph, can I store this in your closet? But Joseph is just, doesn't care. You are my blood brother, and I want to give you the finest gifts. This is what he sent to his dad. Can you imagine? He sent this to his dad, who 22 years ago was told by his brothers, your son Joseph was killed. Here's the robe, the ornamental robe, the coat of many colors. And it's got blood from an animal, but he was tore up. So his father is going to see his brothers come in just a moment. And the donkeys were loaded with the best things of Egypt, and 10 female donkeys loaded with grain and bread and provisions for his journey. And then Joseph says this, hey you guys, don't quarrel on the way. Don't quarrel on the way. Now, most of us have gone on a road trip. And most of us quarrel, not even on the road trip. Now, I don't know, I just grew up in this kind of family, but we usually fought growing up before we ever got in the car. There was fighting going on. With my stepfather, why are you bringing so much stuff? I don't know. Mom packed me. I don't know. You got to take it. Then you go to my mom. Why are you bringing so much stuff? Well, I knew growing up, I'm like, well, that's just, you know, my stepdad and my stepmom. And until Amy and I got married, and then we began to go on trips and vacations. We've been married 32 years now. But the first couple of years, it was like we got into these, especially when the kids were there. And if you're not any good at the game Tetris, you're just not going to understand the importance and primary of packing things in the minivan. And I think I'm better at it than my wife. And but what I'm not very good at is realizing how sensitive or fragile things could get hurt, and I might pack them underneath something that... So we would argue. That's not really what they're arguing about. Don't quarrel, don't argue on the way. I mean, road trips are destined for this anyway. And we men, we will never ask for directions, but these guys, they knew where they were going. It's like going home from church. I know how to get home back. Don't have to fight about which way to go. But some of you who are married will still fight. No, I don't think we should go down this road. I think we should go the other way. But okay, that's not what they're fighting about. They are going to quarrel about little things like, well, I told you we shouldn't have sold Joseph into human trafficking and slavery. That's a big quarrel. These guys, hey, I'm telling you, these brothers are freaking out. And we're going to see it in the next couple chapters. They're realizing our brother who we did this to, if he wants to enact vengeance, we are all dead men. And what they don't know is that Joseph is so far removed from any kind of vengeance, he is just glad to be able to protect his family, his relatives, his father's lineage and heritage. So don't quarrel on the way, because there's baggage to unpack. And there's so much to consider. And they are about to step foot into the presence of their father. And boy, do they have some splaining to do. When God is moving in your family, you've got to trust that God is working behind the scenes. And listen, Jacob has no idea this is about to come to his front door. In fact, the only thing that Jacob is worried about, right, is that my son Benji is not going to return. That's all he's really caring about, I'm sure. Text doesn't say it, but I'm sure from what we've read in the past. Verse 25. I will So they went up out of Egypt and came to their father Jacob in the land of Canaan. And they told him, here we go. Joseph is still alive. In fact, he is ruler of all Egypt. Jacob was stunned and he didn't believe him. You see, this leads into our second point, is that I will forgive the sins that my family has committed against me. You see, God is at work in the family behind the scenes, but as they come clean, and this is what I was talking about before, as the brothers are like, okay, God, you're working in our family, there's just no way we can get around this. Dad, we are liars, and we sold your son into slavery. Verse 27, when they told him everything Joseph had said to them, and when he saw the carts, you know, he looks out the window like, oh my gosh. They're from Egypt, right? I mean, my boys didn't steal this, right? they had sent to carry him back. The spirit of their father was revived. That means hope. He is hopeful again. And Israel said, I'm convinced that my son Joseph is still alive. I will go see him before I die. Again, he's living up in the area of Hebron. And we're going to see here in a little while, I think it's next week, he's 130 years old. Jacob, waiting for Benjamin, he finds out both his sons from Rachel are alive. He is revived. He's like, yes, we will leave this area. So all the brothers, they begin to gather their belongings. They're loading up the trucks, and they're heading back down to Egypt. Jacob here, here's what I'd like to say, is he's nervous. Text doesn't say it, but it's a clear connection. He's unsettled about going. And when God is moving in your family, number three, I'm going to call on the name of the Lord. So Israel, this is Jacob, he set out with all that was his. How much stuff is that? And when he reached Beersheba, he offered sacrifices to the God of his father Isaac, Abraham, Isaac. And this is what Jacob's doing. Here's what I want to tell you. Beersheba is a really, really special place. In fact, Elijah at the bottom and Hagar, God spoke to Hagar there. And Elijah, he's running from Jezebel. He gets refreshed in Beersheba. No, it's not a bar. Refreshing a beer. It is this area where I don't know, there's something special about this area. Because in Genesis 21... Abraham calls on the name of the Lord. He plants a tree, but he also calls on the name of the Lord. And then Isaac, he builds an altar, and it says in Genesis 26, 25, he calls on the name of the Lord. What? And now we see that Jacob is offering sacrifices to God. Now, you might remember Jacob, Bethel seemed to be kind of a special place for him, but for the family, there's something interesting about Beersheba. And have you ever called on the name of the Lord? As a believer, you're supposed to call on the name of the Lord every day, essentially, all the time. So what does that mean? It sounds real spiritual, right? Calling on the name of the Lord. Lord, like, what are we talking about? So when we gather different scriptures that use this phrase, calling on the name of the Lord, we are humble and we are dependent to God, our creator and redeemer. And then Abraham, 12:8, Abraham built an altar and called on the name of the Lord back in Genesis. He publicly thanked God in that section. He praised him, sought God's protection and guidance. So as Christians today, the difference in knowing about God and knowing him personal, That is this whole thing of, it's so natural that we will call on the name of the Lord, because it implies that I know him personally. It indicates that we have interaction. It's a form of worship, actually. And it implies that we are dependent upon God. So, call on the name of the Lord. Are you, and when, are you calling on the name of the Lord? It's a sense of humility. If you're a UFC fighter, it's tapping out. I need help. I need you to stop. It is that moment where you run out of gas and you call on the name of AAA or your spouse or your best friend, or I need help. I'm humbling myself. I can't fix this situation on my own. I need help. I will call on the name of the Lord. So, Jacob was told by his father, who's Jacob's dad? Isaac. And who's grandpa? Well, that's Abraham. And so there's a lot of information and interaction that Abraham had with his God that he told to Isaac. And there's a lot of that information that Isaac told to Jacob. Jacob was told the Abrahamic covenant, which is Genesis 12, Genesis 15. Go back and watch this video later if you want to look at some of these passages that talk about such important communication between God and choosing Abraham and saying, I'm giving you this land in Israel and that whole area. It comes from God. So this is why Jacob, now leaving the area, and he's kind of like, is it okay if we go to Egypt? I get that there's a famine, but should I really be taking my whole family to Egypt? Have you ever had a question like, God, give me direction. Show me which way to go. So call on the name of the Lord. And in his case, that means Jacob is going to offer sacrifices. And look what happens. Leads to point number 4. We got to follow God wherever he leads. Verse 2, and God spoke to Israel. Who's Israel? Jacob. God changed his name. I know I've said that a couple times. In a vision that night, and said, Jacob, Jacob, here I am, Jacob replied. And God said, I am the God of your father, Isaac. And here's what he says. Let this just fill your heart this morning. Don't be afraid to go down to Egypt. I'm going to make you a great nation there. I will go down to Egypt with you. I will be with you. And I will surely bring you back again. And Joseph's own hand will close your eyes. God spoke to Israel. By the way, we don't have any recorded examples where Joseph gets a message from God like this. God spoke to Jacob a bunch of times. Genesis 28, Genesis 32, Genesis 35, and then of course here. But he said, don't be afraid to go down to Egypt. Why would Jacob be afraid? Because Isaac told Jacob and Esau, get and take for yourself a wife only from our homeland, not down there in Egypt. And Jacob's grandfather, Abraham, any interaction, and Isaac, any interaction with Egypt was not a good thing. So Jacob is like, is this wise? I get that they've got grain, but maybe we should just stay here. Joseph can hook us up with, bringing us food. But God tells him in this dream, I'm going to make a great nation there. So that was very helpful. And I know this might be digging in a little deep, but just bear with me for just a moment, because I want to explain why this is important for God to tell Jacob, it's okay. I know you're afraid to go to Egypt, but I want to remind you of Genesis 15. I told your father, this is God speaking to Jacob, I told your dad, Abraham, and Jacob would have known this. The Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves. Afterward, they will come out with great possessions. Guess how long Joseph and the Hebrews are going to be in Egypt? They're going to fulfill this exact verse. So this is, and they're going to become this like huge nation. And he says, surely I am going to bring you back again. And this goes to Genesis 28. Isaac's blessing Jacob about Abraham's promise. This is a big family thing. May he give you and your descendants the blessing given to Abraham so that you may take possession of the land where you now reside as a foreigner, the land God gave to Abraham. So here's what Jacob is receiving. I'm concerned about going down there. We're leaving. I mean, all of our possessions are gone. We're leaving this area. Am I disregarding the promise? And no, because look, God knew, God's plan, God's will is that it's okay to go to Egypt for this time. You see, the will and the plan of God for Jacob is different. Jacob, I want you to go to Egypt. Abraham and Isaac, don't go to Egypt. But Jacob, I want you to go to Egypt. And this is what happens sometimes in our lives. We're like, you grow up and you're like, well, I'm supposed to do what my parents did. Or I'm supposed to, I get a really clear calling of what someone else, what God's told somebody else. And I'm like, God, but what about me? What do you want me to do? And that is a great prayer. God, I understand you called my parents, or you called my spouse, or you called, but what about me? What is your plan for me? You may have called my brother, you may have called my neighbor, you may have called somebody at church. You may have a plan for them, but what is your plan for me? Whatever that is, we need to obey. Verse 5, Jacob left Beersheba, and Israel's sons took their dad, and Jacob and their children, their wives, and their carts. Jacob and all his offspring, they went to Egypt, taking with them their livestock and the possessions they had acquired in Canaan. They're going to come back 430 years later, Exodus 12, which is 1445 BC. Verse 7, Jacob brought with him to Egypt his sons, his grandsons, granddaughters, daughters, all of his offspring. God used Joseph to save Jacob's entire family. And in the same way today, never underestimate your role within your extended family. That God could have raised you up to redeem and do things that your family wasn't able to do, but they're going to do. You're going to be able to be the one to save them. Now I'm skipping the next 19 verses. We're going to jump down to 26. You get to go back on your own and read the genealogy. It's amazing. But I'm going to let you do that on your own. Verse 26, all those who went to Egypt with Jacob, they were direct descendants, not counting his sons and wives, were 70 in all. Well, why is this a problem? Well, because in Acts chapter 7, verse 14, it says there were like 75. Well, where do we get the discrepancy? Well, Septuagint reading versus this manuscript, we look in there and excluded are the two sons of Manasseh, the two sons of Ephraim, and one grandson. It jives, but anyway. What a blessing, which leads us to point number 5. I will rejoice in every blessing. Now Judah was sent ahead to Joseph to get directions to Goshen. And again, if you ever watch the Ten Commandments, they always talk about Goshen and the Hebrews, right? When they arrived in the region of Goshen, Joseph had his chariot made ready, and he went out to Goshen to meet his dad. It's been 22 years since I... Dad, you sent me to go find out about the brothers? That was 22 years later. As soon as Joseph appeared before him, again, the appearance, he's on a chariot, and he looks very Egyptian. Jacob's like looking at his son, 22 years older, from 17 to 39. I mean, we look different, right? He threw his arms around his father and wept for a long time. A long time. It was a long time. Ugly cry. Beautiful. Masculine. It's okay. Israel said to Joseph, "Now I'm ready to die. I've seen for myself that you're still alive." In other words, my life is complete. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "I will go up and speak to Pharaoh, and I'm going to say to him, 'Brothers of my household who were living in the land of Canaan, and they've come to me, you guys are shepherds, you tend livestock, you've brought along your flocks and herds and everything you own. When Pharaoh calls you in and asks, what's your occupation? You should answer, we tend livestock. We're shepherds. And we want to settle in the region of Goshen, where all shepherds are detestable to the Egyptians.'" Now, something really important about this. One of the things that Isaac had always told Jacob, don't go down to the Egypt and this and that, is because you're going to intermingle and it's going to become a problem down there. You're going to lose your identity. And I think as any Christian missionary, if their family is going to leave the United States and go to a different foreign country, we're trying not to Americanize that area. We want to bring them to Jesus as missionaries. And anyone, and that's why when people come to the United States, we become this melting pot kind of place, and we can lose our identity. Ask any individual whose family has moved from another country to the United States, and they're like, you know, we're kind of becoming Americanized. And so by this location geographic and staying there in Goshen area, it's a great area. They are, by the way, they're detestable, but and this class system there, but they're not going to lose their identity as Hebrews. Three things I want you to do this morning, this week. Just number one, Jacob's sons committed a crime against Joseph, and they lied to their dad Jacob about his death. First thing I want you to do, number one, will you forgive the sins of your family members? The sins they have committed against you. And if you're a Christian, the answer to that should be yes. What does that mean, Pastor Dan? Let's say somebody abused me and my family. Well, it doesn't mean you guys got to go to a baseball game or you're going to go shopping together and you're going to be best pals. It just means that I'm giving you forgiveness. Jacob forgave his sons, and Joseph forgave his brothers because God was at work in the family. Number two, God told Jacob to go to Egypt. When God tells you to move, will you trust and obey his direction? Let's say God has been something you've thought in your life. I think God wants me to do this as an occupation, and all of a sudden he says, no, I want you to do this. When God says, hey, I want you to go love on your neighbor, here's an opportunity. God tells you to move out of our couches and to reach our neighbor. Will you trust and obey his directive, his leading? And then number three, you got problems? Will you call on the name of the Lord to worship him, to praise him, seek his direction, request his protection, and ask for his will and purpose to be done in your life. I believe God wants to work within every family, and you hearing my words today may be the catalyst, the one who's going to start the change in your family. What an honor and a responsibility we all have. Jesus, I thank you for this reminder that you are at work in our families, but the first person that you're at work in is me. It's myself. And I want to honor you in my thoughts and my actions and my deeds. I pray that you would give me a true reflection of my attitude toward my family. And I pray that you would increase my hope. That you would bring me to a place that I would believe the person who's been trying to hurt me. That I would be forgiving. That it would start with me to be the one to renew the relationship again. Forgiveness can be one-sided, but restoration involves both parties. Reconciliation involves both parties. A giving and receiving of forgiveness. God, that's where you want to lead all of us. And before we can ever get to a place of revival, before we can ever get to a place of you using us in a mighty way, we've got to be right before you. So we pray, God, that you would reveal and bring to us anything we need to get right before you. Because it is your plan and purpose to work with broken vessels like us who are in need of a Savior. And we pray, God, that in all we do think and say, that we would honor you. Start with us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
It is in Christ alone that we are able to accomplish this. He fills us with the love. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song, his cornerstone. This solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I lay. Light of the world, my darkness slain. Then bursting forth the glorious day, up from the dead he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on. Precious blood.
Trust in Jesus. Amen.